Christian Audio presents The World Jesus Knew, Life, Politics, and Culture in Judea and Around the World. General Editor, Seth Pollinger, Ph.D., with Randy Southern. Narrated by Bob Souer. About this book. The World Jesus Knew is a fictional account set during the last week of Jesus' earthly life as recounted in the Bible. The story begins with his triumphal entry into Jerusalem and concludes with his resurrection. Oddly enough, Jesus remains a minor character in this portrayal, as he is seen from the perspectives of various other people. Yet it is an account based as much as possible on reliable information about first-century Jewish and Roman history and culture. The author has attempted to condense such relevant information and include it in the brief openings of each chapter. The events of the story take place somewhere around AD 33 in Jerusalem. Judea is under the jurisdiction of the Roman Empire, a fact that causes consternation, irritation, and sometimes full-fledged outrage among Jewish citizens. Also troubling to many of them is the suspicion that their religious leaders are forming political alliances with the Romans and perhaps sacrificing the integrity of their law in the process. In addition to Jesus, other significant biblical and historic characters in this story include four of his disciples, Simon Peter, the other Simon, John and Judas Iscariot, Lazarus, the high priest at the time, Caiaphas, and his father-in-law, Annas, Pontius Pilate, and Herod. Peter's mother-in-law is mentioned in the Bible, but not by name. Here she is called Miriam. Fictional characters whose stories are interwoven with these characters include Eli, a self-serving priest, Jared and his brothers in Jerusalem for Passover, Uri, an older man who becomes something of a mentor to Jared, and Hannah, a new follower of Jesus. These characters are not found in Bible dictionaries or history books, yet they are intended to reflect similar people who lived and likely had similar mindsets and motivations. To aid the reader's understanding of the world's culture of Jesus' day, brief introductions precede each chapter. These introductions spotlight a different topic, such as the role of women, trade and commerce, or religious practices, for each chapter. They compare, contrast, and connect events that were occurring in Israel with events that were happening in other cultures and nations around the world at the time of Jesus. Near the end of the Bible's book of John, we read, "Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written." John 21:25. This book is not meant to comprehensively cover the life of Jesus, yet here the reader will find much to ponder between the various perspectives, the behind-the-scenes glimpses, and the opportunity to get a first-person perspective of the world that Jesus knew. Chapter 1. The Politics Jesus Knew. Israel's place in the Middle East in 1st century AD. The Israel in which Jesus lived and ministered was a far cry from the conquering nation that cut a wide swath through Canaan under the military leadership of Joshua. Likewise, the golden years of Israel's monarchy, the reigns of David and Solomon, were but a page from history in Jesus' day. In 587 BC, the Babylonians, led by King Nebuchadnezzar, laid waste to Jerusalem and destroyed the magnificent temple that Solomon had built. Nebuchadnezzar's army exiled the people of Israel to Babylon. That defeat proved to be pivotal for Israel. After the Babylonian captivity ended around 538 BC, a succession of empires assumed control. The Persians ruled the land until 333 BC, when the Greeks, led by Alexander the Great, conquered it. The descendants of Alexander fought over regional control and were relatively benign conquerors. At times, Jews were allowed to rule their own affairs. Jewish self-rule ended in 63 BC when the Roman general Pompey conquered Israel and absorbed the land of Palestine into the Roman Empire. Rome appointed its own rulers over Israel and maintained a pervasive military presence in the region to discourage rebellion. Despite the Romans' oppressive presence in Israel, the Roman government gave the local Jewish leaders limited freedom to work out their own religious disputes and affairs. Some Jewish people looked to the priests and teachers of the law for guidance not only in religious matters, but in social, legal, and political matters as well. In order to maintain their political position, the Jewish leaders had to strike a delicate balance. Some felt they had to cooperate with Roman authorities without giving the appearance of cooperation. Others wanted to fight. Still others abhorred Rome, but were looking for a solution that didn't involve physical conflict. The leaders of Israel often compromised the best interests of Israel to ensure the peace that the Romans required of their conquered territories. Rome's demand for compliance put pressure on local rulers to keep a close watch on Jesus and his followers. Different factions tried to prevent any social movement that could get out of control and would also threaten local balance among religious leaders. The leaders all struggled with how to appease Rome, and they drew the line in various places. It was a power struggle where the goal, for many, was to keep their own power. Eli snaked his way through the crowd gathered in the courtyard of a house in the village of Bethany. The house was small compared to others in which Eli had heard Jesus speak. Two doors were cut into the mud brick walls of the courtyard. One led to a storage area for tools and equipment. The other led to a larger storage area for animals. Eli kept his arms folded into his chest as he moved through the assembled throng. He knew from past experience that many of the people who gathered outside Jesus' teaching engagements did not come only to hear him speak. Many came to be healed of all manner of afflictions. Eli shuddered. The realization that he might be pushing past someone who was possessed by a demon or suffering from a blood disorder caused him to pull his arms more tightly to his body. He climbed 7 steep stairs to a landing. The door at the top of the stairs was blocked by a group of men jostling for position. Eli opted for a less populated spot near a window, just to the left of the men. Unfortunately, Jesus and his disciples were on the opposite side of the room. Eli could see everything that was happening, but he couldn't hear anything but murmurs. He grabbed the windowsill, squeezed his body against the wall, and turned his ear to the opening, hoping to hear more. "Whose house is this?" he whispered to the man next to him. "Jesus is staying at the home of Simon," the man replied, the leper who was cured by his power. Eli immediately let go of the sill and took a step back from the house. "A leper!" he exclaimed in disgust. He held his hands out as if they had been contaminated. The disease itself was bad enough. Even worse, though, was the ritual impurity it created, forcing isolation from friends, family, and public worship. It was a loathsome condition that generated fear in many Jews. "Do not concern yourself," the man replied. "Simon has been made clean by Jesus." The man placed his own hand on the wall to demonstrate his point. Eli regarded him warily and then turned his attention back to the house. Inside, nearly 2 dozen people filled the small central living area. The interior was dark. Several oil lamps, strategically positioned throughout the room, cast odd angled shadows on all 4 walls. The sunlight that filtered through the windows was obscured by the figures of those, like Eli, who crowded into their openings. The feast was over, though a few people were still reclining at the table. Others were milling about, talking with one another and with some of Jesus' disciples. The rest were gathered around the teacher from Nazareth, or so Eli assumed. From his vantage point, he couldn't actually see Jesus in their midst. He noticed that several people in the room were pointing to and staring at a man who stood near 2 women. "How healthy Lazarus looks for one who spent 4 days in the tomb," the man next to Eli said. Lazarus. Eli turned and scanned the crowd in the courtyard, looking for 2 men who might be doing their best to remain inconspicuous. He did not see them. They will be near the front door. Before he left the window, a movement inside the house caught his eye. The crowd parted, and Eli could see Jesus seated near the table. One of the women who had been talking with the disciples picked up a large jar and approached Jesus. She knelt before the teacher and poured the jar's oily contents over his feet. A wave of excitement rolled through the room as the smell of perfume, very expensive perfume, Eli noted, filled the air. One of the disciples, the treasurer, the one known as Judas Iscariot, stepped forward. With forceful gestures, he pointed to the woman and then to the empty jar. His voice was lost in the din, but his displeasure was definitely not. The woman kept her back to Eli. Still on her knees, she was using her long hair to wipe the oil from Jesus' feet. Jesus held up his hand to calm his outraged disciple. He gestured toward the woman in a way that, even from a distance, left no doubt as to his approval of her. The rebuked disciple stormed from the house. Eli gave a moment's thought to going after him, but he had a more pressing matter to attend to, one that he would surely have to explain later. He left the window and hurried through the crowd to the front door, where some of the guests were starting to emerge. Lazarus was not yet one of them. Eli spotted the two men he sought standing in the street, facing Simon's house. The crowd had parted in such a way that the guests leaving the feast had to walk past the men. Eli joined the line of people filing out of the house. Ahead of him, the two men shifted their stance and stared intently at the departing guests. Each one had slipped his right hand inside his cloak at chest level and held it there. Eli carefully approached the men. They failed to notice him at first, focused as they were on Simon's front door. A quick wave of his hand finally caught their attention. Their eyes went wide when they recognized Eli, so wide, in fact, that he felt compelled to look around to see if anyone else had noticed. He glanced back at the men, gestured to their concealed hands, and then shook his head once in a deliberately exaggerated movement. The two men looked at each other and then back at Eli. He met their confused glances with another shake of his head, a confirmation of his previous gesture. The men removed their hands from their cloaks. Sunlight briefly glinted off the handle of a concealed weapon as one of the men pulled his outer garment closed again. Muttering their frustration, the two men walked away quickly, pausing to look back only when shouts of, "Lazarus! Lazarus!" erupted from the crowd. The brother of Mary and Martha, the second most popular person in Bethany that day, returned to his home unharmed, without an inkling of how close he had come to death the second time. Eli stopped a couple who were walking away from Simon's house. Did the teacher reveal where he plans to go after he leaves Bethany? The woman smiled broadly. "Last night, two of his disciples were guests in our home. During the evening meal, they told us." Eli fixed the woman with a cold glare that stopped her in mid-sentence. Her smile vanished, and she took a step backward. "His disciples revealed to us that Jesus will depart for Jerusalem tomorrow," her husband continued as he stepped in front of her. He was clearly more intimidated than his wife by this interrogation from a stranger. His cheeks and forehead burned bright red as he cast his eyes downward. Eli shook his head and brushed past the two of them. The walk to Jerusalem, a distance of less than 2 miles, exceeded the limits of a Sabbath's journey. According to the oral traditions of the Pharisees, Eli was forbidden to make the trip until morning. He stayed with his companions in Bethany another night. A morning haze burned off quickly as Eli made his way down the southeastern slope of the Mount of Olives to Jerusalem. Near the village of Bethpage, he saw two men emerge from a house near the road. They stood for a moment discussing something. One of the men pointed toward Jerusalem, the other shrugged his shoulders. They turned in unison and began walking in Eli's direction, back toward Bethany. They did not hurry, but there was a purpose in their gait. As they drew closer, Eli recognized them as two of Jesus' disciples. He could not recall either man's name. "Peace be with you," he called out. If either man returned his greeting, Eli did not hear him. The breach of etiquette bothered him, but did not deter him. "I see you were out early this morning, diligently working on behalf of the teacher we all follow." The two men slowed their pace, but did not stop as they approached him. "Are we not always doing the work of our teacher?" one of them replied. "Indeed," Eli agreed with a vigorous nod. "Indeed we are. May I assist you in preparing for the teacher's journey to Jerusalem today?" Eli hid a smile with the back of his hand as the disciples exchanged glances. He wondered if these were the two men who had stayed with the couple in Bethany. "The arrangements for Jesus' journey have already been made," the taller of the two replied. "We require no further assistance." His tone was cordial but firm, so Eli bade the men farewell and continued on his way. He had other ways of gathering information for his associates. As Eli neared the house from which they had come, he glanced over his shoulder. Jesus' disciples had disappeared around a bend on their way back to Bethany. He took a deep breath and approached the door. "Peace be with everyone who dwells within these walls," he called. The door opened and an old man limped out. He leaned heavily on a carved staff as he walked. "Peace be with you, young man," he replied. "Sir, I have been sent to your home by my master, the teacher, Jesus of Nazareth," Eli explained. "What more does your master require of me?" the man asked. He did not try to disguise the annoyance in his voice. Eli waved his hands and shook his head. "No, no," he insisted. "He asks nothing more of you. I am here because the servants he sent to your door have proved untrustworthy. The teacher has sent me to make certain that his requests have been clearly stated and granted." "They have," the old man told him. He raised his staff and pointed it at Eli. "Now you tell me, Will your master prove himself to be trustworthy? Will he swear to me that my donkey will be returned after it has carried him to Jerusalem?" "A donkey?" Eli nodded. Caiaphas, the high priest of Israel, considered Eli's words for a moment. Then he too nodded slowly, as did a dozen other priests, scribes, and elders who had quickly assembled in the large reception area of Caiaphas's palace to hear Eli's report. The significance, the audacity of the image of a donkey was not lost on anyone as familiar as they were with the prophecy of Zechariah. The general population might not be educated enough to associate a donkey with the anticipated arrival of the Messiah, but this group certainly was. "After calling Lazarus from the tomb, does he now presume himself a king?" one priest asked. "The whole world is running after him," another noted. "Long have we endured the blasphemies of this man," Caiaphas said. "For almost 3 years have we witnessed his callous disregard for the oral traditions of our people. For 3 years have we been made to look foolish by his parables and teachings," a scribe added. "Yet now his own pride and lust for power makes itself known," Caiaphas continued. "We must devise a plan that will make the Romans take notice and quiet his opposition to our leadership. So it shall be left to the Romans to do what the law requires to put this blasphemer to death?" one of the elders asked. "How long must we be forced to live with these brutal leaders?" another priest muttered. "The day will come when we will be freed from their tyranny," Caiaphas replied. "Until that time, even brutal leaders can be made useful. They may rid us of an insidious enemy." Eli gazed at the faces of the men gathered in the room, among them the most powerful Jewish leaders in all of Israel. A surge of pride swelled within him. They had gathered here because of news that he had delivered, news acquired through stealth and subterfuge. Modesty did not prevent him from believing that one day these men would regard him as an equal. His moment of triumph was short-lived. "And now you must answer for your actions in Bethany last night," Caiaphas said. The chief priest had spoken with his back turned to Eli. For a moment, Eli wondered if the chief priest's words could have been directed at him. When everyone else turned to look at him, his suspicion was confirmed. "Our servants informed us that you brought attention to them and prevented them from carrying out their assigned task as Lazarus left the house." Eli held his ground. "Forgive me, Caiaphas, but those servants were sent to kill a man who had been brought back to life once already. What if Jesus had..." Eli stopped before he said, "raised him a second time." He realized his thoughtless words gave the Nazarene too much credit. But it was already too late. Caiaphas thundered, "They were sent to kill a man who claimed to have been raised from the dead. What reason had you to interfere with his just punishment? As long as Lazarus is walking around, he persuades gullible people that this Jesus is someone who can challenge our authority." Eli closed his eyes and held up one hand. "The intent of my words was clear," he insisted. "We must be careful. We can't risk giving this blasphemer any more opportunities to make us look weak and foolish." Caiaphas paced at the edge of the room. He stared out the window at the upper courtyard, where the remnants of a bonfire still smoldered. After several moments of contemplation, he stood next to Eli and addressed the group of men. "Our young priest does not yet understand the importance of speaking precisely. However, in this matter he has shown wisdom. We no longer need to provoke this blasphemer from Nazareth. He will deliver himself into our hands with his words and deeds. Soon all of Jerusalem will know of his blasphemy. We need only to continue to keep a close watch on this man who has escaped our traps for 3 years." The high priest placed his hand on Eli's shoulder. "Jesus of Nazareth will soon give us just cause to act, and when he does, we will act swiftly. The teacher will be in our hands before his followers realize he has been taken from them." "How soon does this man plan to make his entrance into Jerusalem?" one of the other priests asked. "The roar of a crowd near the eastern gate of the city," answered his question. Chapter 2. The Empire Jesus Knew. The Roman Empire in 1st century AD. The 33 years of Jesus' life coincided with the rise of the Roman Empire as it expanded in its power and influence. At its apex, the empire comprised 48 modern countries. Its northern boundary lay in modern Scotland, its southern boundary in North Africa. From west to east, the empire stretched across Europe and into Asia, all the way to the modern border between Iraq and Iran. The extraordinary Roman road system, which extended across the empire, connected the world in a way never before possible. The intricately planned thoroughfares made long-distance travel safer, faster, and more convenient. The world Jesus knew was rapidly becoming smaller. In time, the region of Judea, in which Jerusalem and its surrounding areas were located, was established as a client kingdom of Rome. Herod the Great, a half-Jew, ruled as a Jewish king, but lived his life very much like a Roman. He was not governor of Jerusalem. The Roman governor lived in Caesarea. The Jewish people were not fooled by his title. They recognized that ultimately Herod had to answer to Rome. Following Herod's death, Israel was governed by a combination of Herod's sons and Roman officials, including Pontius Pilate. The concept of Pax Romana gave conquered territory some degree of autonomy, but the paganism of the Romans and the monotheism of the Jews were on a collision course from day one. Add to that the tax burdens that Rome placed on Israel, and it's not difficult to pinpoint the roots of rebellion among certain factions of the Jewish people. After centuries of struggling with foreign rulers, many Jews debated about how they could throw off the shackles of Rome and live in independence. They remembered a century and a half earlier when the Greek Empire and its vile ruler Antiochus IV Epiphanes had pushed them too far in attempting to corrupt their worship habits and absorb them into a worldwide Hellenistic society. Outraged Jewish dissidents had organized and eventually defeated the Seleucid army, regaining their freedom and enabling them to cleanse the temple. Was that the response they should take now against the despised Romans? A great dispute occurred along a spectrum. Some advocated revolt, others flight to the desert, while others chose compliance. How long will we wait before we seek out a hostel? The town square of Jerusalem was bustling 4 days before Passover. Pilgrims from throughout Israel packed the marketplace to fulfill their ritual obligation to spend the money they made from selling their first fruits. They bought meat, fish, leeks, dried fruit, nuts, and wine sweetened with honey. Others attended pottery workshops where artisans created cooking pots and other things. Noam, Jared, and Seth, brothers from the city of Tyre, over 100 miles north of Jerusalem, stood with dozens of other travelers in the center of the activity. The travelers stood apart from each other in groups, a husband and wife here, a family of four there. A few groups numbered more than a dozen, and many men stood alone. But as far as Jared could see, he and his brothers were the only trio. His older brother Noam carried a large pack that contained, among other things, the brothers' Passover clothing, the whitest garments they owned. His younger brother Seth, the one who had posed the question, held a hemp rope tethered to a lamb whose appearance had no blemish or defect. Jared started to answer Seth when a tall man, dressed in a purple cloak, approached. Behind him, several onlookers stared openly at his attire. Purple garments were rarities in the villages and towns from which many of them came. "You are weary from your travels," the man said in a loud voice. "I welcome you as guests to my home. You will share our Passover table. You will eat your fill of our food and drink your fill of our wine. You will sleep in our guest room on our roof." Jared bowed his head to the man. "My brothers and I, peace be to you and everyone who dwells in your house," came a voice from behind him. The tall man brushed past Jared and approached the largest group of travelers, who appeared to be a three-generation family made up of some 15 adults and children. The family's patriarch bowed low to the approaching host and continued his greeting, "We would be honored to share the Passover in your home." The tall man signaled to four servants who stood nearby. The servants gathered the family's belongings, including their own lamb, and led the group away. The tall man continued on to the marketplace. Jared watched the servants and large family leave. When he turned around, he saw several other travelers talking with potential.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.